Welcome, students. Let's have the today's topic. Today's topic is principles of reliable data transfer. And this question, principles of reliable data transfer, it is a 100% question of your GTU exam. It can come for your 8 or 10 marks of question. So this is a very big answer. And in one class, it is not possible to complete the topic. So we will have it in the two slots. So moving towards the next slide, here you can see what is the meaning of our reliable data transfer, how it is going to work out. Understand the diagram, understand the concept, so that whenever the exam will come, you can write the answer if you are going to draw the diagram. So the very basic thing is you should know how to draw the diagram, from where to where the message is passing, what is happening. If you will understand, this answer will be very easy for you to write in your exam. So now here you see, as you can see in the diagram, I have here one client, and here you can see the server side. So the client is going to send the data. Okay, you can see the data. The client is going to send the data and the server is going to receive the data. That is the reason the client is known as your sending process and the server is known as your receiving process. And in which layer they are going to work out? As we already discussed, it is going to work out from application layer to transport layer and also through your network layer. So whenever they will send the message from one side to another side, the message has to pass through one of the channel. That channel is nothing but your reliable channel. So here, as you can see, how it is going to be work out. One more diagram is there. Here, whenever the reliable channel is there, here you can see, again, same thing, the client side, the server side. So the data will come from the sender side of reliable data transfer protocol. It means the message, whatever we are going to send, before the sending the data, the message will be very reliable. There will be no tampering of your data. The data has not been lost. So in your sender side, you will have the reliable data. And through by using the protocols, HTTP, it is going to send from one place to another place. So here we are going to have the first layer. What will happen? Here the layer is there, my OSI layers, application layer and transport layer. The data will move from application layer to transport layer. When it will move, it will have the reliable data. Now next, when it will move from transport layer to network layer, it has to go through the channel. Okay, so that channel can be your reliable channel, can be your unreliable channel. So here, the previous diagram, whatever I have shown you, the previous diagram is nothing but reliable service abstraction. This is the diagram of your abstraction. This is the process of the data. But moving towards your implementation part, you can see this is a reliable service implementation. The channel can be reliable, can be unreliable. Then when you will send your packets through the channel, it will again move to your server side from network layer to transport layer. It will receive all the data. Then it will move from your transport layer to application layer. What is happening actually? So here you can see this is a data sender side reliable data, while receiving in your receiver side also the data will be your reliable data. So the channel is known as your reliable or unreliable channel. That is the implementation part. Whenever we will have the abstraction, it will be having your reliable channel. When we will go through your implementation part, they are going to move towards your unreliable channel. So now, next you can see here, how actually it is happening. So I have written here some points. Complexity of reliable data transfer protocol will depend strongly on characteristics of unreliable channel. What is that unreliable channel? The loss of data, the corruption of the data, or some reorder of the data. So what is the meaning of this? The meaning is like, whenever we will send the reliable data strongly from the sender side to receiver side, it will have their own characteristics. And then we will send all these reliable data here through the unreliable channel. Unreliable channel, it provides if you have any corruption of data or loss of data or any if you want to do the reorder of data, all these things are possible under your unreliable channel. So the message, the reliable data we have sent, but when it has been passed from transport layer to network layer, we don't know what happened with the data packets. That time we are going to send all these data through your unreliable channel, and then in the output side you can see the data will be like properly ordered data, and if any corruption will be there, it will be properly implemented. So now you can ask me that how it is happening. In this channel we are using the algorithms that we will read later to make our work proper, to make our data proper. In this way, they are going to send it to your receiver side. Next, also one more thing you can see, one more point. Sender and receiver don't know the state of each other. The sender will not come to know in the receiver side all the message has been received or not. And in the receiver side also, they won't come to know that the sender how much data packets they are going to send, unless they will send the acknowledgement of the data. Once the acknowledgement will reach in the sender side, sender will come to know that yes, the receiver side, they have got the data packets. So now here you can see these all are the implementation parts, how it is happening. Here there are some versions of your reliable data transfer. The first one we will see that RDT. RDT is nothing but reliable data transfer. In the question paper, you can get the version name. We will see all the versions slowly. This is your reliable data transfer protocol interface. How we are going to use this RDT in terms of your programs. When we will send the data here in the application layer, we will take the name as RDT underscore send. Okay. And when it will deliver or receive the data, these all things are user defined. Okay, you can write down. But in the programs, we used to write in this way so that it will be easy to understand. Now you can see here in the receiver side, here it has been written deliver underscore data, or you can write receive the data, anything. So now here in the sender side implementation of RDT or reliable data transfer protocol. Here we are going to send the data packets. So what will happen? We are going to send through your unreliable data transfer, right? Here we are going to do the unreliable data transfer. That is known as your UDT. We know that whenever we will send the message, always it will, the message will be added with the header part. So here the header has been attached. So now we are going to send the unreliable data with the like header and the data or message through your unreliable channel. When it will receive inside your receiver end, that time it will come like your header and data. So here when it will receive, and if anything happened with the data here, because reliable we have transferred, here something happened and the data has got here and there, it is not in the proper order. So here the data are your unreliable data. So these data are passing towards your channel, and here you are going to receive your reliable data. So the reliable data transfer received in your transport layer. So once it is received, it is going to pass like this towards your application layer. So the deliver of the packets, you will get it. Whatever I have told you, everything has written in this way. So RDT underscore send, it is called from the above, from here, and it will pass the data to deliver to receive the upper layer. It is going to pass to your the data to your down layer so that it can take the data from upper layer and can send to the down layer. What is happening here? This is nothing but unreliable channel to receive the data. Okay, and this one is calling your this function. This UDT underscore send is calling your RDT underscore send. This function is calling to the previous upper layer function. Next, what is happening here? You are going to receive the packet in your receiver side when the packets will get delivered. What is happening here? You are receiving the you are getting the delivery of data towards your upper layer. That is nothing but user defined functions. Now, this is nothing but your bidirectional communication, which you have to remember. It is a bidirectional communication over your unreliable channel. Why it is called as your bidirectional communication? Because once the data will get received in your server side, the server has to send the acknowledgement through your this channel itself. That's why we used to call it as your bidirectional communication channel. Now, here what is happening? The data packets, whatever has been attached here, both the data packets has been same data packets has been received in your receiver side. But here, whenever we have attached with the message with the header, we call it as your packet, because we know that in the transport layer, we will call all these messages in the name of your packets, making as your segments. We will also make divide all the packets in terms of your segments. Now, moving towards your next slide, here you can see how we are going to start this. So incrementally develop the sender and receiver this protocol. First, what you are going to do, you have to first develop, you have to initialize your RDT. Then you have to consider your unidirectional data transfer. But what will happen? The control information will flow in both the direction. As I told you, this is a bidirectional. As it is a bidirectional, so what will happen? The control flow will go from both the sides. But unidirectional for your data transfer. Whenever you will transfer your data, it will be one side transfer. But the whenever the acknowledgement will come or something else will come, that will be your both the directions, means bidirectional. So one more thing is also there, you have to specify the finite state machine, FSM. What is that FSM? How it is going to work out? It is going to work out in between your two state. Here you can see, this is one state, this is another state. So what is happening? What is the meaning of your state? When in this state, next state uniquely determined by next event. It means, here suppose you have given the state as start. Here the state you have given as stop. So the event will start here, and after some time the event will stop here. So you are providing the actions. What action you are going to take place. So this kind of n number of states you can define uniquely, and you can prescribe that what event and when the event is going to work out. So here I have written, the event will cause the state transition. It's happening, right? The event, I have given the start event here. So whenever it will reach towards your second event, the event will change. So what is the event here? Stop. So the state transition happens in between your start to stop. So the actions also is dependent on your start to stop. In this way, your finite state machine works. Now, I told you that the reliable data transfer is having some of the version name. The first version name is 1.0. You have to see the question paper. If it is not a 10 marks of question, if it is a 6 marks of question, then definitely they will mention you that you are going to write on which version reliable data transfer description. You have to see that and you have to write. So how we are going to send the reliable data transfer over a reliable channel? What is happening? If we will send towards your reliable channel, then definitely it will not have any kind of your beep errors, and it will also not have any kind of packet loss. So in that case, what will happen? If there will be no errors and no packet loss, then there will be separate FSM, separate finite state machine for your sender also, for your receiver also. How it will be? The sender will send the data into the channel. The receiver will reach the data into the channel. So what will happen? How it is going to happen? You can see from this diagram, the sender side it will just wait for the call. This is my event. This is my state. Okay. In the state, what is the event I have given? I have given the event as wait. So wait the call from the above. Still you are not getting the acknowledgement from the above state. Just wait. Then what you are going to do? You have to read the, you are going to send the data's RDT. It means on the reliable channel. Then you are going to make the packet data. How? Make packet of data. Save their data values inside your packet. All these things are your user defined variable names. Then by using the unreliable channel, you are going to send the packet. Then what will happen in your receiver side? In your receiver side, it will just wait from the call below. Because you can see above in the sense, on the top only the application layer, all the layers will be there. But here how it is happening? It has to go in this way and it will touch, right? So here it will call, it will just wait for the call from the below. So then once the packet will be there, so what will happen? First, the as it has been sent the packet, it will receive the packet, okay? The delivery of the data will receive in your receiver end. Then by using the algorithms, we have to extract the packets. Whenever we will extract the packets, we know that everything is segmented wise. So we will receive the data in the form of header and the data, both the things. So we are going to extract the packets. Then we are going to send to the upper layer, that is my application layer. So now the reliable data has been received inside your receiver side. Now it is very easy, right? Now moving towards your next version. What is the next version you can see? RDT 2.0. So what is happening here? The channel with bit errors. In RDT 1.0, you saw that there is no errors, no packet loss. But here you will have the errors, some bit errors. So underlying the channel may flip bits in packets. You will have some errors. If you have the errors, then how you are going to detect the errors? By using the internet checksum. I feel in the last class, we have done how to make the, find out the checksums. We have already done one example. So by using that internet checksum, you have to find out the flip bits, the errors that you have to detect the errors. Now, once the error you got, how you are going to recover the errors? Through your channel with bit errors, how you are going to recover? What you are going to do, whenever you will find out that yes, some errors are there, then you have to use the acknowledgement. Once the acknowledgement will come, this acknowledgement will send, it will tell to the sender that the receiver packet, the packet has been received in your receiver side. If it will send the negative acknowledgement, means NAK, you can see all these terms in your diagram. If it is ACK, means it is a positive acknowledgement. If it is a NAK, it means it is a negative acknowledgement. It will say, the receiver will say to the sender that the packet has some errors. If the packet has some errors, what to do now? The sender has to retransmit the packet again with the receipt number. We used to have a receipt number. Here also we have one receipt. That with the NAK receipt, it is going to send it back to the receiver side. So that time, what will happen is the stop and wait state will work out. I told you the state transition. Here we are going to use the stop and wait. The sender sends one packet, then waits for receiver response. It will wait to get the acknowledgement or negative acknowledgement. According to that, it is going to work out. Now we will see how our finite state machine is working under your RDT 2.0. So sender is sending, it is first waiting for the call from the above. It will have the send data. Then it is having some of the packets. It will make the packets with the data and the checksum. Because know that in RDT 2.0, it will have some flip data errors. So we have to check the errors. So when we will make the packet, that time we have to keep the data with, along with that we have to find out the checksum. All these things, make it together and keep everything in this packet. Next, you are going to send through your unreliable data transfer. When you are going to send that, it will wait for the acknowledgement or negative acknowledgement. Once if it is a received packet, if proper acknowledgement, then no problem. Two things it is going to work out. It is a negative or it is a positive. So now what will happen? If it is a negative acknowledgement, what to do? Again, you send it back. Again, the sender has to send. If it is a positive, no need to send. So what is happening in that time in the receiver side? You can see in the receiver side, it will just wait to get the packets from the sender side. It will receive the packet and some corruption of the data. Okay. It will have two options, negative or positive. If it is having the corruption of the data, first it will, what it will do? First it will receive unreliable data with the acknowledgement, then delivery of the data. Then it is extracting all the received data packets by using the algorithms. If it is not corrupt, then send it back. If it is corrupt, then again it will send back here. If it is not corrupt, it will send to the upper layers. But when it will receive in the upper layers, here also it will be unreliable. Once it will receive here as a reliable data transfer, it will match. If it is having some of the corruptions, again it is going to send it back to your sender side. That time, this process will work out. So here, the state of receiver, what it is going to do, it will somehow and all, it will communicate with your receiver to send the packet once again, if it will have the negative acknowledgement. So in this way, it is going to work out. Here I have highlighted, it is a negative acknowledgement, it is a positive acknowledgement of the received data packets. One more thing is also there, if there will be operation in RDT 2.0, but without any errors, what you are going to do? From the sender side, you are going to wait for the above. Same thing we are going to send, data and checksum. Again, we are going to wait for the acknowledgement. So if you have negative acknowledgement, same thing, or positive acknowledgement. But here what we are going to do, the extra things only, the thing is that we are going to wait. If we will wait, then only we will get the acknowledgement properly, if there will be no errors. Okay. So now here you can see, so these things and all, how it is working. We are going to send the packets and it is going to be not corrupted data. But these things will work out when, if you have the acknowledgement properly. Then if you have some corrupted packet, then what will happen? If you have some corrupted packet, first you are going to wait. Here also, in the receiver side also, you are going to wait. This part will work out. And next, what it is going to do? Corrupted data. But if it is having the not corrupted data, then this part will work. What it will do? It will send the negative acknowledgement. Whatever I told you, same thing is there in the diagrammatic way. Then this part will work out, send it once again. The data, you are going to send it once again. And here, if it is not corrupted data, then it is good. It has been received with your acknowledgement value. That is all about your RDP 2.0. Now we will see here what happens if acknowledgement or negative acknowledgement corrupted. What will happen? The sender will not come to know what is happening in the receiver side. And without knowing anything, the sender cannot retransmit the data always. If he will retransmit the data, then it will be a duplicate data. Then suppose you transmitted the data, how you are going to handle your duplicate data? The sender transmits correct the packet, is acknowledged, or negative acknowledgement will be corrupted. So what the sender will add? It will add the sequence number to each of the packet. First, it will add the sequence number to each of the packet. Next, what it is going to do? Then it is going to receive all the discarded, does not, if the receiver discards it, the duplicate data, then it is not going to work out. Now, next. So now in this way, you are going to use the stop and wait transitions. The sender will send one packet and the receiver will wait for the response. This is all about your reliable 2.0.